Hi everyone. So thank all of you for sharing your stories and allowing everyone to really understand this practice. I'm just going to ask, I have just one question for each of you. We'll go turn by turn and then leave the floor open to the audience. So Fatema, this is the first time that you have chosen to share the story of your Khatna experience publicly through Rasika's powerful performance. We know that it takes a lot of courage to take that step and to choose to share all these deeply personal stories. I want to ask you, what is it that prompted you to speak out and share your story of your Khatna? And you know, tell me about the moment when you decided that you want to take this step.
Okay, so the first time I became aware of this was, there was an article published in the newspaper. And I come from a very religious background. So my dad just came and they were like, these people just want to shame us. They're just against our community. They got nothing to do with this. And I didn't tell him anything. I just read the article and I felt that, you know, this happened to me. You wouldn't know why they are taking a stand against it. So then I looked up on the internet and then I found Sahiyo. And so I thought that it doesn't matter what my parents think about this. It matters what I went through. So that is why I decided to join and speak about this.
Thanks. I want to ask this question to Insia actually. Talking about Khatna openly does come with a bit of backlash from the community. We all know that often happens. And the backlash can come from family members, from relatives, other members of the community. So can you tell us about any experiences you may have had in terms of backlash?
Okay, so this is a topic we generally don't talk about. The reason I talk about it is I'm a mother of two beautiful girls. So I decided I need to be vocal. I can't put them through what I went through. So yeah, I have been writing articles for DNA. I've been mentioned in places for being an activist. So last time I did that, I had people sending me pictures of me and saying, what the hell is wrong with you? Just shut up and sit at home. Why the hell are you shaming the entire clan over it? And I was like, this is something that's happened to me. It's my story. Why should someone have a say about it? So it became quite a discussion in the family, and I have a huge one. So yeah, people did decide that, okay, we will not speak to you if you go ahead with it. But I'm yet going to go ahead with it, because I have a voice and I want to be heard.
Thank you so much. That really takes a lot of courage, and coming from the same community, I know how much courage it can take. Samina, I wanted to ask you, what do you think is the way forward for communities like the Boras, or now we know that there are families in Kerala who also practice this. So any communities that is practicing this, what do you think is the way forward towards ending this practice? What approach do you think would be most effective, or approaches?
See, you know, this is my personal thing. Ending any practice is not very easy. It's not going to be easy, because no community is going to come and say, okay, you know, we did wrong, we're going to stop it, it's all over, okay, it's all fall. No, it's not going to happen. But yes, if we can create awareness like we have done through Sahiyo, if people listen to my story and they feel, nahi yaar, you know, there is something that we need to think twice, and it's not making any sense actually, and it's only harming, you know, in case if there is something which is good, okay, I think it should be okay, but there's nothing good. So create awareness, and if people are listening to my story and if they're going to stop doing it to their daughters, I think we've made some difference in the society. You know, that little is what, you know, they say, you know, that little one drop makes an ocean. So probably if we, you know, a few of them would stop practicing it after listening to my story, we can make a difference. Then probably, you never know, you know, future, yes, this would just stop altogether.
I'm very sure this is going to make a difference, because your voices are now going to be amplified to a great extent, and it will influence a lot of mothers, I'm sure.
Thank you.
Does anyone in the audience have any questions?
Good evening. My name is Firoz Patch. I am from the Hindustani Prachar Sabha. Only last month, we had a conference on crimes against women and children. Insia was there. Joe, you were there. Now, I only wish to make a comment, and that is, why don't some people wake up and make this act an act of crime against women and children? After all, you are putting a seven-year-old defenseless girl on the cross. It's not fair. And even if you make it a crime, how is she going to file a case against her parents or whoever? But a public interest litigation, declaring it as a crime, will help. I think we must understand that we are in a civilized democratic society in the 21st century, and we need to do something about it. And by a great coincidence, this morning I read a quotation from Martin Luther King, the Nobel Prize winner, who said, "Your life will begin to end if you remain silent about what matters."
Thank you for that comment. And yeah, I mean, you're right. We definitely do need a law. And actually, just there might be many of you who may not be aware of this. So there is actually a public interest litigation in the Supreme Court at the moment. That is, I mean, they've had about two or three hearings maybe, and that's made a little bit of news. But there is an attempt to ask for a ban on this practice. And we do know that the Ministry for Women and Children has been considering this. But we really hope that they take it up very seriously, because in the last hearing at the Supreme Court, the ministry filed an affidavit which said that you know, there is no official data to prove the existence of this practice in India. But I mean, it is, if by official data they mean data collected by government agencies, then the onus is on the government to start collecting that data. And we really, we hope that that work begins soon, because there is definitely need for more research and resources to put towards that research. And I think what the other point that you brought up is equally relevant, that, you know, whenever we do have a law, the question will remain about, you know, who would want to file a case against their own parents or their own family members. So I think that definitely remains a challenge. Because of that, we would need the other approach of educating the community as well. Do any of you want to make?
The Bori community is supposed to be an educated, emancipated community in a lot of ways. How come that a lot of your educational institutions don't impart this kind of awareness? I know a lot of teachers. I know the principals. I've been to the Bori school in Muhammad Ali Road, that huge big school there. But I wasn't aware of this, otherwise I would have brought this up at that time. I'm talking about 20 and 30 years ago. But how come that now the young ones cannot take it up with them and talk about it?
All right, so the deal is very simple. We want to take a stand, but it's about shaming our families. It's like a religious practice that has gone on and on for so many years that it's not really taken seriously. Today, me sitting here, tomorrow I know 40 of my relatives will stop talking to me. Sometimes our parents stop talking to us because, according to them, what should have been discussed in the home, you're bringing it out. No one will ever tell you what's happening in there. So somehow, I understand when Arifa is talking about it, we need to talk amongst ourselves, we need to support each other. Because the fright that people will stop talking to you is a very big thing in us. It's a taboo of the most unheard sort. So if you see, we know each other, we are there to support each other. So somehow it will take time. It's not going to happen by shaming people. It's going to happen by supporting, loving, having conversations over tea, and trying to make them understand this needs to stop.
You know, I've seen the women folk come out in large numbers when your Saidna is driving down Marine Drive and overly sea face and things. I mean, at that moment, you should capture that moment and get the women to express themselves, you know.
The irony is that, you know, many of those women actually support the practice and they don't think that it is harmful. They think it is necessary for being a good mother, for being a good Bora. So, and the latest narrative that is emerging from the section of the community that is in support of the practice is that, you know, this cannot be classified as FGM because it is just circumcision. It's just like male circumcision. And, you know, the World Health Organization's classification is itself wrong. And what we do is, the term that is used in Arabic is cuffs. So they say what we do is cuffs, it's not mutilation, it's not, I mean, we. That's the reason why we don't use the word mutilation anymore. We call it female genital cutting, because mutilation is a controversial term. We know that, you know, mothers don't intend to harm their daughters, definitely. And it that they, you know, there's no malicious intent, but it's still cutting.
I don't know how many people are aware of why they have this mutilation of the female genital. Would you like to expand on that?
Maybe you guys can talk about the different reasons you've heard in your families.
It's supposed to diminish your sexual urges. I mean, that is the main reason. And that
actually, it's very controversial because some people say, or at least the other side is saying, it increases pleasure. So I don't understand how it does that. But as I had written in my earlier story, that it didn't make any difference to me as a person. Like, really nothing. So I don't know what was missing, but as I say, I don't agree that you take a seven-year-old and do what you feel like. You can't change my body just because it's a convenience.
I've had a personal experience of a friend who had Khatna done, and she has no memory of that. And she was also 7 and 8 years old when it was done. But there's no sexual satisfaction as a result of that. And as a result of that, her marriage is broken off. But she said she actually doesn't know any better. You know, I mean, and I think these are things which need to come out and be talked about.
There's a huge variety in the kind of experiences that women have had. So we've had, or like there are women who've had to go to therapy after marriage because they weren't able to get intimate with their partners. And they've struggled with it for years. And then there are also women who have not really had any sexual difficulties or emotional difficulties. So there's always that clash, I think, in any conversation with community members about this. There's always like, you know, but we weren't affected, so it's not harmful. But the focus needs to be, I mean, the point is that even if one woman is affected, you need to rethink the whole practice, because why is it done? And why was it done, in like what reasons were given to you when you started questioning this?
So the first reason they gave me was it's for hygiene, which I still don't understand how it promotes hygiene. So that's the only reason I was given. And also I would like to put two contradictions that happens here. First is that Muslims are not allowed to do post-mortem and they're not allowed to donate their organs because they say that the way Allah created you is the way you should go up. Not even one part of your organs should be missing for donating. So then why are you cutting off a part of us and then saying ki theek hai, matlab it's for hygiene purposes? You're just contradicting your own sentence. Yes, thank you. And then there's one more contradiction that I was thinking about. They say it's for hygiene purposes. So then why are you doing it in an unhygienic way? Like the house which I went to was dirty and the blade and the cotton was not hygienic. So then what are you trying to say? I don't understand that.
And you were, I mean, you're really young, so this is not very long ago in Mumbai, right?
Yeah. Yes.
What about the women's commissions and things like that? Have you approached any of them? Have
they
come
forward? The National Commission for Women has supported the cause, but I mean, they have publicly supported the cause, but I don't really know if that's having an impact in terms of actually bringing about legislation.
Yeah, because there's all this talk of beti bachao, beti padhao, and all that, and it, I know it's getting politicized, but it's about time they saved that too.
So basically, that's the problem. People are not willing to come out and talk. Today, I will tell you, I have unlimited Bori friends, but none of them want to talk about it. They're like, let it be. If we even go to some place to put, say, a registration or anything, okay, there's no legislation against this, but who will talk? Today, if I want to really go to the Women's Commission, the first person I'm incriminating is my mother, who unfortunately was pushed in by her sisters or her mother. So it will be going back generations. It's not going to really help us. So I don't know how this will go ahead, but yes, maybe us talking out loud might force a few more to come out.
Isn't your Saidna supposed to be very forward-looking, the modern one?
I mean, we're really hoping that at some... we're really hoping for a time when he will... listen to our voices and help us with this and ask the community to end this practice, because the day he says that this practice should end, I'm like, it will definitely end, because everyone listens
to
him.
I wish you all the best.
Thank you so much. Thank you, all of you.
Can I just say something?
Yeah. I would like to add something here.
Okay, after you.
See, I am an atheist, so my life is pretty easy and simple. I feel bad for all the believers. But no, I respect you, follow your religion. The only question, you're taking a cue from you, Fatima. You need to ask your Sayyidina, your community leaders, that do you believe in a false God? If you believe in the real God, who is perfect, that means he also made you perfect. So by cutting you, a perfectly healthy child, are you questioning your God? That he made a mistake? If your God made a mistake, then he's not the real God. Stop believing in that God. But if you really believe in your God, then he made you perfect. And don't question your God. Don't cut your children. You need to ask your community leaders that.
Samina, you wanted to say thank you for that.
Yeah. Just a little thing that I want to say is, as ma'am was saying, you know, why don't we just come forward? Why can't we talk about it? I'll tell you my personal thing. I was not the kind who would actually ask, you know. If somebody would say, ye karna hai, okay, fine. You know, let's just do it. If you go to the mosque like this, okay, let's do it. But, you know, again, I was, of course, under the influence. And, you know, there is sometimes you follow someone. Okay, she's doing it. It must be good, you know, because it's happening. So, you know, let's do it. But when, you know... I met Sahiyo, and you know, she told me that there's this group, you know, would you like to come? And I was like, okay, you know, what is it? And I think the first day when I came and they asked me, you know, what happened to my daughter, and I think I just couldn't speak, you know, because that's when I realized that there are a lot of people who were sitting there, you know, we women who were all together, were all someone like me, you know, who would not have a platform to speak properly, because this is something that you don't actually sit and discuss with a family. It's not like I can call a friend and say, okay, you know, is it, do you believe in it? Or do you want to do it? Or why did you do it? It's not something that you actually talk about it. It's a very subtle thing. Okay, you know, you have to do, nobody talks about it, because I have never heard till date anybody talking about this topic itself. Okay, it's supposed to be done, it's finished, over ho gaya. But after I met Sayo, I joined, I realized ke actually, yes, why didn't I ask at that time? You know, of course, I'm going to regret it like really bad. But the thing is, why didn't I ask? If I would have asked just one question, even to my mother-in-law, or even to, you know, whoever wanted it to be done, why are we doing it? No, I mean, okay, you wanted cut, okay, you know, practice hai, it has to happen, but why? There has to be some reason for something happening. Even as simple as you want to brush your teeth, you're brushing your teeth, but why are you brushing your teeth? So everything has to have a reason for it. And I think after joining Sayo, I have opened up. I want to ask, so when I told my husband also that I'm going for something like this, he's like, that's your call and we are here to support you, my brother, my sister, my parents, of course, you know, my mom, dad, everyone, they were like, yeah, I mean, we did it. We didn't have the courage probably at that time to probably ask. And now you have it, just go ahead. What happens later, dekha jayega. That's not very important. My only reason for being here is not saying that this community is wrong or this thing is, you know, the whichever XYZ community is practicing, so it's wrong, you should ban. No. My only motto was here to be, okay, people hear it, think about it, and, the mothers regret it the most. So don't let that happen to your daughter. Please don't let that happen. Give her a chance to think. Give her a chance, tell her what is happening, Like in ours, there's one more, when you have your periods, for example. It's like one celebration thing, okay, you got your period. So I'm going to tell my daughter that very soon you're going to get your period. So same way, I had to tell her, okay, there is something like this, and this is going to happen. So do you want to go ahead? Like periods, you can't say, no, I don't want to do it. But at least I'm giving her an awareness, ki ye ho raha hai. And this will happen. So just want to create awareness among a lot of people and a lot of women, a lot of mothers saying that don't go ahead with it. Just think two times before you take a step. Thank you.
Thank you so much. And I think before I close this panel and hand the mic back to Insia, I just wanted to point out that this is not only about the Bora community, because there are many communities who do this, maybe not in India. Like last year we found out that it's happening among some people in Kerala as well, not entire communities but families. But no one's speaking about it really there. It's just really the beginning of a movement in Kerala. But all over Asia, the United Nations has not really accounted for so many Asian countries where FGC is practiced in its official kind of statistics. So this is about speaking for all communities who practice it, whether or not they're in India. And this is about questioning all social norms as well that are discriminatory or oppressive towards women or anyone. In any other community that may not have this practice, but you have menstrual taboos, you have so many different things. We need to question all of these social norms, and we need to think about Katna in that spirit as well. So, thank you all. Thank you so much.